starting off tonight with None Shall Pass Oatmeal Stout from Devil May Care Brewing in Winnipeg. It describes itself as a strong beer with big notes of dark chocolate, coffee, figs, and of course the usual oatmeal stout taste. I'm not going to bother going through all the Monty Python-esque jokes on the side here. I think I've read them out before when I've had this beer. So tonight I'm going to be trying to repair this little tool from work. This is a JDSU branded visual fault locator. Viavi is the current brand name if you want to search for these online or whatever. But it is essentially a small laser light source. Comes out there that you connect onto the end of a fiber optic patch cord and turn it on, and it flashes a visible laser light that you can use to locate the other end of this, or to locate breaks in it, in the fiber jumpers, or light leaks. And I think actually I got a break there that we might be able to find if this thing was working, which it currently isn't. So that is the plan for tonight, to try and get this thing working again. The problem with it, well, the initial problem was the batteries are dead. So I went and pulled the first battery out and just unscrew it like any of the little penlight flashlights. And the second battery is completely jammed up in there, which I assume means that it is probably failed, leaked, and corroded up in there. This should be a super simple little repair, I'm hoping. If it's horribly wrong, if it goes horribly wrong, then, well, then it won't be a repair video, I guess. So I don't think that unthreads. I mean, it's a good guess that it might, but that's not moving. I've just got a bit of tape on there, so I don't mar it up too badly. How do I get that out of there? Looks like there's a little notch in there. I wonder if I can get a spudger into that. That's just bending the spudger. Where's one of the stronger ones? Oh, it looked like it moved a little bit there. Yeah, it's moving. Okay. It's also bending the spudger. It's in there pretty solidly, but it is moving. Okay. This might go faster than I thought. I wasn't sure how I was going to get in there. Oh, there we go. Yeah, it's as I suspected. We're full of battery crud. Okay, so this just comes back to a cleaning then. Let's use a brass bristle brush to clean that off. It looks like it's not actually corroded directly onto there, which is good. It's just the crud has gotten itself on there. So this particular one is one that just lives at one of our facilities. And I hadn't used it for a while, and then when I went to use it, of course, it didn't work. That was the easy one. Now then, how to get that out? Ah, it looks like there's a little bushing in there. That makes sense. That would keep the spring from flopping sideways into the barrel and shorting it out. But that means that I have to push it through, I guess. I wonder if the handle of my pointer is strong enough or skinny enough to go through there. Not budging. Try a little bit more aggression here. That's not moving. I don't know how I'm going to get that little burger out of there. There. Took an Ardox nail and ground the tip off it to make a punch. And there is my bloody battery. Now I got to get in there and clean all that crud out so that the next one that I put in doesn't get stuck. Starting as I usually do with alcohol, just to get the majority of it out first. This is methyl, methyl hydrate, or methylated spirits if you prefer. I tend to use that rather than isopropyl, which is a lot more common, a lot more commonly used. And the main reason I do this is because it's more readily available, especially right now. It's not something you want to use for cleaning your hands, which is why it's easier to get my get right now. It's just as good a solvent, and it still dries clean. There's quite a bit of crud coming out of there. Oh, well. I'm going to carry on with this for a while. So hopefully, with some cleaning and some abrasion with that emery cloth and some more cleaning, I can get that barrel nice and smooth on the inside again. Let's see, which way up does that go? That way? Super tight fit. That's not great. How am I going to clean that out? And where is my tight spot? See how good that emery paper does on polishing up the inside. And of course I'm cleaning all the dust out of there after each time I do that too. Now then, will that fit in there? Still not quite. Where is that stopping? That's the bottom of the battery. It's the top of the battery. So stopping right there. Oh yeah, you see that rough spot right in there? That's just about that same depth. Oh yeah, I can feel it. Ever so slightly. I think this leaky bastard may have buggered me up for good. But we'll keep persisting.
A little longer than a few minutes later.
Okay, let's try that. I've been through it with the emery paper and with some coarser sandpaper and taken a fair bit of stuff out of there. And I think now, where's my new batteries here? Oh, wrong end. Starting to get a little punchy here. Yeah, that goes down into there nicely. And the business end threads back on, as it should. So now we just have to, I guess, press this guy back in. I'm hoping that I can just... Oh yeah, look at that! It's working! I just have to press that back on somehow. I think that worked! Let's put the optical part back on, the laser and optics. Yeah, man, that works. So, as you notice, this thing can create, I've just got the little condom on there. I'll aim that right at the lens. There you go, laser. But that's easier to see. So as you can see, it gives you either a flashing or a solid. And normally, I find the flashing is a lot easier to identify what's going on down the fibers when I'm trying to pick it out in a brightly lit room just out of a bundle of jumpers or something. Okay, there we go. That's better. So, as I was saying, this is designed to go onto the connector here. This is an SC connector. They also make adapters for the smaller LC connectors. And you can see how easy, even with the cap on, it is to see which fiber I'm on. Now picture a patch panel with you know, 50 or 100 of these hanging in front of it that somebody hasn't bothered to label properly. You can see how that would make it really easy to find where the other end of your cord is. Let me just try this on the other one. So you can see there is still a bunch of light getting through there, but if we take a look in here, you can also see that there's light leaking out where that break is, pretty obviously. But here's another failure mode that you can see. If you bend a fiber too far, it's called a micro bend, and you can see the light escaping as I bend it. That light escaping is a loss in the fiber, because if the light's not getting to the far end, then it's obviously getting lost somewhere, right? And then that type of a bend that I made, which is about the diameter of my thumb, that's not usually going to cause permanent damage. You want to avoid doing it, because if you do it enough, it will cause permanent damage. But as you can see, there's still light getting through. And if I put that bend back on it, I think you can see that that's getting weaker. Some of the things that you can use this thing for, and why I use it quite frequently at work, not this particular one. Like I said, this one lives at a facility that doesn't get a lot of visits, but the one that I carry with me in my truck absolutely gets a lot of use. But this one is going to go back into service. Obviously, this wasn't an official repair, and it's certainly not a recommended repair method, especially for a, it's basically a laser flashlight, but it is a piece of test equipment. It is a fairly expensive piece of test equipment, actually, surprisingly. Let me show you. For something, for what it is a relatively expensive piece of kit. I mean, $225, this is American dollars. Yeah, they're not a cheap piece of equipment. Of course, other manufacturers, aka the usual suspects in China, make much less expensive ones. I don't know how good they are, but they are definitely much less expensive. I mean, at that price, it's almost disposable price, right? So there we go. That wasn't too high tech of a repair, and it definitely wasn't an approved repair method. But now this thing's working and available again, so I call that a win. Yeah, so comments, questions down below as usual. I guess that's everything. Thanks for watching. I will talk to you later.